Okay, Lucia asked me to give a presentation about mathematical aspects without using formulas, which is for a mathematician, of course, a great challenge. So I try to explain the ideas without going to the technical details. So the presentation I'll give is very different from what I used to do. I used to show equations, derivations, and sometimes proofs, but I try to explain the concepts. The idea is to share with you some of the work we did in Europe on atmospheric modeling and prediction of atmospheric processes. Was work done before we jumped into the Colombian problems, which are way more complicated than the European ones, as Angela already explained you, because of the very complicated meteorological conditions here in Europe. Things, especially in Holland, is we have no mountains. It's very flat, so meteorological conditions are a little bit more simple. Okay, so that's the idea.
One moment.
I need both hands. Is this the pointer? Yeah. So my talk is about mathematical modeling about of atmospheric transport problem, not the meteorological conditions, but about the transport. It's about data assimilation, because if you use a model and you want to have the model realistic, that it has really a connection to the real world, you have to confront it continuously with data. So that's the second part, and that's, well, my own main interest or my own contribution as a piece of the puzzle of the whole system. Okay, and then we have two applications. Ozone. We have smog too in the Netherlands, not as serious as here and not as frequent, but so one, two times a year we have a period of smog and we want to predict it. Nicolas already explained the chemics behind ozone, and it's the same in Holland, of course. And another one is more recently volcanic ash, because we have had a huge eruption in Europe, which blocked for a few days the entire air traffic. So nobody could take the plane. So it was a $1 billion loss of all the countries in Europe. So then there was the trigger. We need to predict more accurately the volcanic ash distribution over Europe. Okay, let's start with the modeling part. We didn't do the modeling ourselves. The model has been developed by one of our big institutes of technology, TNO. TNO is bridging the gap between universities and industry. So it's a consultancy, scientific consultancy firm with a lot of support from the government. They have built the model over the last, I think, 30 years. So it's a numerical model. It's 3D, so a horizontal grid, and in the vertical you can define the number of layers. It's based on the advection diffusion equation. It is connected to the meteorological models of the meteorological offices, so you have the actual meteorological input. You can define up to 21 species. They all are connected. It depends on the application, of course. Volcanic ash has no chemical reaction, it's only transport, but ozone, of course, has a number of species that interact with each other and are responsible for the creation of ozone. So then you have to include more species. But there are many different type of applications where you need different type of species. Chemical reaction, of course, is there, which is numerically hard because the system becomes stiff in the sense that some components react very fast and others very slow, so you have to take that into account in your numerical scheme. But okay, that's done, or that's not our work. They have, I think, something like 10 PhD students have worked on this system on all small aspects, and what we did was the data part in the system. So the modeling part was already done by colleagues of me. And the key in the whole system is emission database. So you need to know the emissions, in this case over Europe. It's a lot of data where you have to reconstruct from the data the emissions at every location. And then you also have to define masks. There is an annual cycle. There is a weekly cycle because Tuesday is very different from Sunday with respect to the traffic. And of course, a daily mask, day and night are very, very different. So this is all there. It's a huge system. A lot of knowledge is already there. And this was not our part of the model. We use the model and we don't develop it. We tune the model and we do not change the numerics inside. Okay, an application here is ozone. It's tropospheric ozone, so the bad ozone, which is connected to smog. So Nicolas already explained to you that this is a combination of different species that together create or may create smog. Now this is the grid that we use. This is the most common grid. If you are interested in the Netherlands, of course, it's in the middle. You try to put the boundaries far away so they don't create problems. And in this case, we used the four-layer model, four layers in the vertical. The data are the small triangles. I come back to that later. First, the model. Well, if you see the result, this is a kind of result at some point, at some moment in time, and you see that we can have pretty high concentrations here. This is the Italy, the industrial area of Italy, so that can be explained. We don't have no idea how this comes on. That's Romania. We don't have data there, so there is a huge emission, but we cannot confront it with the data. Here, this is the German industry. So you can reasonably explain why this is the case. Okay, this is the model. Very complex modeling system, and models are never perfect. So there are many uncertainties, especially in this type of work. As Lucia told you, I'm also working in coastal sea modeling. And then life is way more easy. The number of uncertainties there are relatively small, and we can predict the behavior of the sea pretty accurate, within a few percent of the results. Atmospheric chemistry is way more complicated. There are many parameters involved where we do not have accurate values for. We have the emission database, which has been gathered over the last decade, and it's definitely not exact for the moment that we are using the model. So it's based on the last few years of data, but today it's different from 2 years ago. So there are a lot of uncertainties there. Meteorological input is also prone with, the models are pretty good, but still for transport problems, long-term simulation, if your wind is not perfect, then at some point your plume will not go in the right direction. We will have examples for that later. Boundary condition, you have to restrict the domain of your problem because you cannot compute the atmosphere in the whole world. So you have to restrict the domain of your problem, and then of course the boundary condition have to be prescribed. That's mathematics. You have to have a unique solution of your model, so you need boundary conditions at every boundary along the domain. But of course we use the model to compute the results and not to specify the result at the location. So that's a complication. Okay, and then our part of the job was we wanted to use data to improve the model and to correct the weaknesses of the model in order to make the model really describing the actual physical conditions. So the idea of data assimilation is not simply post-processing, that you do a run and you have data and you make the model results a little bit more close to the data. That would be easy job. No, the idea of data assimilation is to use the data to reduce the uncertainties of the model that we have just prescribed. So the idea is a two-step procedure. So first you have to point out where the uncertainties are, and then the next step is use the data to only reconstruct these uncertainties and to keep the other parts of the model as it was before. Like in atmospheric transport modeling, we have mass conservation. We did a lot of effort to have a numerical scheme that is conserving mass, and then we don't want that using data to improve the model that you create mass somewhere, somehow, just because you want to have the model result closer to the data. So the idea is that you use data to improve the model, but you do not want to violate the physical constraints, the underlying physics. So therefore this two-step procedure. First, the modeler has to point out what do you think is uncertain, and then the data is used to reconstruct this uncertainty, and everything which is not considered uncertain will not be touched by the data. So the first part is modeling. Nobody is agreeing on this, so there are a lot of uncertainties. So one scientist prefers one type of uncertainty, the other one another one. So this is typically a debate where to blame the uncertainties or where to blame the errors of the model. The second part is mathematics. Once you have defined it, then it's just a matter of finding the optimal solution. So that's step two is completely a mathematical algorithm to come up with a solution of the problem that was defined in step one. Okay. Well, there are two methods. We implement them both. They both have their pros and cons. I won't go into the detail. One is the assimilation filter, where you create a number of model simulation to represent the uncertainty, and a variational data assimilation is more for parameter estimation if the uncertainties are only specific parameters. Then this approach is a very attractive one. parameters could also be the initial condition, for instance. That's what is done in numerical weather prediction. These two methods are... You can understand me, yeah? Is it... should I, or is it... Okay. Well, let's first see what an ensemble filter can do. The idea is to model uncertainty. Yeah? The step one in the data assimilation procedure is to represent the uncertainty. In the ensemble Kármán filter, this is done by just running or creating different possible model simulations. So you can be done in different ways. Usually, if you, for instance, specify parameters to be uncertain or the boundary condition to be uncertain, you create a number of different parameters, different boundary condition, and run the model. And then you create an ensemble of simulations which a priori, without having data, there are no preferences. Everything could still be reality. We don't know yet. We just created the uncertainty. We specify the uncertainty, and we represent the uncertainty by a whole bunch of simulations. Think of the order of 50, 100. 100 is a nice number, so everybody is using 100 in the literature. Depends on the application. Once you have the ensembles, then step two is you create a Gaussian distribution of it. So from the ensembles, you compute mean and covariance to represent the uncertainty in terms of a Gaussian distribution. And then life is easy, because if everything is Gaussian, then mathematician knows very good what to do with data. So we have a Gaussian distribution of the model uncertainty. You have data. Data might be uncertain too. And then it's a kind of standard trick to improve the model results using the data. And at the end, of course, we should come with a new ensemble which represents the uncertainty. So the ensemble spread will be smaller because the model will be more accurate. You can even prove that data will always create an ensemble which is closer to each other. Okay, so this is the general concept. How can you create ensembles that can be done in a very different way? You can have a very specific one. Yes? Here, this is a Gaussian distribution, can be represented by an ellipse, where the uncertainty is in these directions. If this is a two-dimensional Gaussian distribution, so we could take one member in the middle, one in this point and one in this point, and then of course we can create the ellipse, and we know the whole distribution in terms of the Gaussian density function. So here, think this is an ensemble member, which in our case is the result of a full model simulation, so at one time. So here, of course, it's two-dimensional, and here it's just a realization in two dimensions. But in our case, this is the state of a system, a model simulation at a certain point. So in our Lotus Eurus system of ozone, it was something like 200,000 or 300,000variables. So this is a vector of 300,000. And this one too, and this one too. They all represent possible conditions of the atmosphere. So in every grid point in the model for every species. So this is in some sense a very simplified picture to illustrate the idea. Well, this is a specific one. You can also choose them randomly. You can choose a whole bunch of them randomly to represent the uncertainty. Okay, this is the most attractive way. Almost in all applications, this is the easy way to do, and it is also a very accurate way. So we do this usually also in a random way. Okay, now go back to the application ozone. This we saw before, grid with the data. Now we focus on the data. The grid has been on the slide before, so we try now to use the data to improve the model. Okay, we have to say something about the uncertainties, and there are many uncertainties in these type of models. I already explained that. In this case, we blame the emissions. The emissions, yeah, I'm not an expert in atmospheric chemistry, but my colleagues say the emissions are the dominating factor in the creation of smog in Holland and Belgium and Germany. So that's what we did. The uncertainties are specified as uncertainties in the emissions. So we estimate the emissions. Okay, and then some results. And we see that here was the original simulation. We saw that already before. And then doing the assimilation, we saw that in this case, the emissions were too pessimistic. So the emissions, the data indicate that the emissions were way smaller than expected. This was not a real smog episode, but this was just a model simulation to see whether we can reconstruct the ozone distribution. Okay, and here you have some, what you usually do is you try to see the results in a location where you have independent data that has nothing to do with the whole simulation. That's the most fair way to see whether the model is doing a good job. And well, we were quite happy. You see here again the model, which was way too large. This is the results after the assimilation, and these are the data, including the uncertainty of the data. So the model simulation was quite reasonably in agreement with the measurements that were available. And again, this is a validation station, so this station was just used afterwards to check the simulation results. So this is reasonable. Well, we were quite happy with this. And of course, the assimilation corrects the emissions, so that's the strong part of assimilation. It's not only trying to improve the model with respect to the data misfit, but it's also reconstructing the emission that should have been put in the model to get a better result. And here you see the correction. It's a correction factor of the emission database. So they are quite irregular, which, well, is kind of worrying that emissions are sometimes really removed at all. And here we see that Dutch emissions here in the location of Holland are very small, while in England they were raised a lot, so that could also be the cause of error in the meteorological model where the location of the ozone was wrong and it was not the emission to be blamed. So, but that's part of the game. If we blame the omission, then emissions, then the methodology has no right or no freedom to choose other conditions. So, okay, this is ozone, and this is the performance of the algorithm. You see here the error of the system in validation station. So we look to the performance of the system, and this is a function of the number of ensembles. So here you see the number of different types of ensembles. So roughly with 50, you see then the limit is there. It makes no sense to have even more ensembles to represent more detail in the uncertainty. The first 50 give the most important uncertainties that are needed for correcting the model. And the number of ensembles is very important because every ensemble member requires a full model simulation, so it's quite computationally intensive. Okay, volcanic ash, other application that we did afterwards. Well, what was the problem here? 2010, there was a huge eruption in Iceland. Well, you see already here the it was a $5 billion loss because the air traffic was completely blocked. So even my daughter was on holiday in Morocco, and her flight was cancelled, and she could go on the first flight 3 weeks later. So she had to stay there for a long time. And it happens to millions of people all over Europe. Amazing chaos. So the idea was, we need to be more specific, because afterwards we will see the picture. It was not necessary to close the whole space for airplanes in Europe. It was overkill. So we should have much more detailed results on the actual concentration of volcanic ash in order to specifically close certain airports but not others. Okay, well, measurements, there are many measurements available. So at that time it was rather new volcanic ash transport, so we start step by step using different types of information in to see what we can do with this. So you see here satellite, that's different types of satellite which we used, and aircraft measurements. Aircraft measurements are very important because after the first signs of an eruption, nobody knows what's going on. So in Iceland they immediately sent airplanes to the volcano in order to measure concentration, and we use the concentration of these aircraft measurements to reconstruct what's going on in the volcano and what the emissions are. So that's the first thing we did, using aircraft measurements. So here you see a track. This is Iceland. This is the volcano. The name of the volcano, I think nobody can pronounce this name except if you live in Iceland. So we always called it the E-volcano, or and then we know. We don't have a lot of volcanoes in Europe. I think two or three are active. Okay, so this was the volcano. So they immediately sent out this plane to reconstruct or to measure the volcanic ash on different heights. And then the idea is to reconstruct the emission. Again, the key element is the emission. How many ash at what height is emitted by the volcano? And then you see the reconstruction. This is the plume that is reconstructed, and implicitly the emissions are the uncertainty here. So, and well, if you have at some point a reconstruction using the data, you can also do a prediction forward in time. Ensemble Kammerfeld is very good in prediction. So then you get these kind of pictures. So you reconstruct the emission, you assume it's stationary, so it goes on forever. So therefore you get a plume. And what you really see that it was overkill to close the whole space here, because there was a very specific plume over Europe. So here in England, there was no reason to close the. If you fly from, even from London to New York, no problem at all. But it was not possible at that time. So, okay. Of course, it's not a perfect prediction. We believe that we saw here another airplane. So here the concentrations were way higher than predicted. We believe that the plume went like this, so that that the meteorological conditions were not perfect, and the plume was on a long run was a little bit more like this. But okay, we had no data there, so we could not predict that better, but we catched up here in Germany with the data, and then the plume was more accurate here. Okay, maybe the last thing is really focusing on the emissions. So this was forward to predict, to reconstruct using aircraft measurements. Here we use satellite data to reconstruct the emissions, which is the vertical profile of the emissions. So it's not, the location is known, but the height is unknown. So here we use variational data assimilation. I shall be brief on the methodology since I'm running out of time. So here we define uncertain parameters, and the parameters are the vertical profile of the emission, and they are constant in time. So once we have it, we assume that the volcano will continue for a few days in the same pattern. Once we have the uncertain parameter, we solve an optimization problem using the methodology of 40VAR. I promise to skip the formulas, so I won't explain how it's done. And the final result is a new model simulation where the emissions have been reconstructed from the data. So the data again is only to reconstruct the emissions, but is not touching the dynamics or the physics of the model in another way. Uncertain parameters are the vertical profile, I already said that. And that turns out to be a complication, since none of the existing methods, the classical 40VAR that is used in numerical weather prediction or the assimilation filter, was able to really reconstruct the vertical profile. And the key problem here is that satellite data is data which is integrated over the vertical, so it's a two-day pattern, and you want to reconstruct the vertical from it. And the information is there, but it's very subtle. It's very hard to get it. Usually it's overwhelmed by errors in the numerical procedure to find a solution. So we made a new one, and then I should acknowledge one of our PhD students, Shalu, that really had the idea to do it. She developed a new version of this methodology, which is able to reconstruct a vertical profile from satellite data, which is integrated over the vertical. So this is mathematics. This is the things that these are the things that we like very much. If things do not work out too easy, then we have to come up with some new ideas. Okay, and this is we always start with twin experiments where we create the truth so we can test our method. For mathematicians, these tests are even more important than the actual result, because our job is to make a tool that works. And then, of course, the next step is using it for real data. And well, if this doesn't work, then we are not to blame for the problems. Here you see it. We created a truth by running a simulation with a certain emission profile, and then we generate data and we see whether we can reconstruct the same emission profile that we had put in the truth simulation. Now, it works pretty fine. You see that this is the original model simulation, that's the blue one. This is the truth that we have made. And if you do the standard assimilation scheme, it is not able to find the reality. It's just stick to the original model simulation because it has only information about the vertical integrated data. And here you see the Chaluz method is really doing a great job, because now the red curve is exactly on the truth that we have created. So the information is there, otherwise it would not be possible, but it's hard to get the information without the method. Is not able to do it because of numerical artifacts. So here the numerical artifacts dominate the problem. Okay, so this works pretty fine. We are happy with this. And now the real experiment, of course, is with data. Well, then the first problems we get is that, well, we have only data. There was a lot of clouds, I think. So after the retrieval and the reconstruction of the the post-processing or the pre-processing of the data, we only get a few spots here. And we use that for reconstructing the emissions and therefore the predictions of the sorry. And this is more detailed where we have the data. This was the original model simulation where we had the emissions that we have reconstructed before with the aircraft. And these are the these are the data, these are the original simulations, and these are the improvements made by the methodology. Hard to see whether there is improvement. We should have had validation stations, and but that's still going on. That's the problem of field data, is always difficult to see whether you actually got an improvement or not. You need a lot of data to test whether your new results are actually better. Okay, I think conclusion. I tried to give a kind of idea what you can do with mathematical modeling of atmospheric transport problems, that you need data to improve the models, and the methodology is working reasonably well. There's still a lot of aspects that can go that can be improved, of course, but that's also part of the fun. All the work was done a few years before we started with the cooperation with Medellin. And well, definitely we found out that the methodology for applying to the valley in Medellin is way more complicated because of the complicated physical conditions. So it's a challenge to work on this type of application. And I think Andres and Santiago, after the break, we'll tell you more about the first results of applying this kind of methodology to the Colombian case studies. So thank you for your attention.